you guess where I first heard tones like these?
No, Mr. Borkman.
Down in the mines.
The mines?
I'm a miner's son. My father used sometimes to take me with him into the mines. The metal sings down there.
Really? Sings?
As it's loosened. The hammer blows that loosen it are the midnight bell clanging to set it free. And that's why the metal sings, in its own way, for gladness.
Why does it do that, Mr. Borkman?
It wants to come up into the light of day and serve mankind.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Borkman, but I'm afraid I must go.
Are you leaving already?
I really must. I have an engagement this evening.
For a party?
Yes.
To play?
Dance music.
You like playing dance music? The parties, I mean.
Yes, when I can get the engagement. I can always earn a little that way.
Is that what you're thinking about as you're playing for the dancers?
No, I'm generally thinking how hard it is that I can't join them and dance myself.
Yes, that's the hardest thing of all. But it should comfort you to know that you have 10 times more music in you than all the dancers together.
Oh, I'm not so sure.
Oh, you must not doubt yourself.
But since no one knows it.
As long as you know yourself, that is enough. Where are you going to play?
At the Hinkles.
The Hinkles?
Yes.
Does that man give parties? Can he get people to visit him?
Yes, the house will be full of people, Mrs. Wilton says.
What sort of people?
I really don't know, except that young Mr. Borkman will be there this evening.
Earhart? My son?
Yes, he's going.
How do you know that?
He said so himself, an hour ago.
Is he out here today?
Yes, he's been at Mrs. Wilton's all afternoon.
I mean, did he come here? Did he see anyone downstairs?
Yes, he stopped in to see Mrs. Borkman.
I might have known it.
A strange lady was visiting her, I think.
Indeed. I suppose people do come now and then to see Mrs. Borkman.
If I meet young Mr. Borkman this evening, should I ask him to come up and see you too?
You will do nothing of the sort. I won't have it on any account. The people that want to see me can come of their own accord.
Very well. I won't say anything then. Good night, Mr. Borkman.
Good night.
Good night, Mr. Borkman.
Come in. Oh, is it you?
Good evening, John Gabriel. Yes, it is me.
I must say you are rather a late visitor.
Well, you know, it is a bit of a way, especially if you have to trudge it on foot.
But why do you always walk, Wilhelm? The tram passes your door.
It's better for you to walk, and then you always say it. There has Frieda been playing for you lately?
She left just this moment. Didn't you see her?
No. I hardly see anything of her since she went to live with us, Mrs. Wilton.
Please be seated, Wilhelm.
Thank you. You cannot imagine how sad I feel now that Frieda's left home.
Oh, come, you have plenty others left.
God knows I have 5 of them. But Frieda's the only one that really understands me. The others don't understand me a bit.
Yes, that's just it. That's the curse we chosen people have to bear. The common herd, the average man and woman, they do not understand us, Wilhelm.
If it was only a matter of understanding, with a little patience one could learn to wait a bit for that. But there is something still bitterer.
There is nothing bitter than that.
Oh, yes, there is, John Gabriel. I had a domestic scene tonight before I started out.
Indeed. What about?
My people, they despise me.
Despise?
Suspected it for a long time, but today they rub my nose in it.
You made an unwise choice, I fear, when you married.
I hardly had any choice in the matter at all. Crushed as I then was, so utterly broken down.
Is this meant for me, a reproach?
Oh, no, heavens.
Yes, you are thinking of the bank disaster.
I can see you are.
Oh, I don't blame you for that, heaven forbid.
That's a good thing at any rate.
Besides, it wasn't my wife I was thinking of. It's the children.
I thought as much.
They have more culture, you see, and therefore expect more of life.
And so your children despise you, Wilhelm.
Well, I haven't made much of a career, you see. There's no denying that.
Do they not know, then, that in your young days, you wrote a tragedy?
Oh, of course they know that, but it doesn't seem to make much of an impression on them.
They don't understand these things. Your tragedy is good. I'm firmly convinced of that.
Yes, there are some good things in it, aren't there, John Gabriel? Good God, if I could only get it placed. Look, let me show you one or two alterations I've made.
Have you brought it with you?
Yes. It's been so long since I read it to you, I thought it might amuse you to hear an act or two.
No, let's keep that for another time.
Ooh, as you wish.
You were quite right in what you said just now, Wilhelm. You have not made a career. But I promise you this, Wilhelm, that when the hour of my redemption strikes, when the hour of my restoration is at hand, when they realize that they cannot carry on without me, when they come here to me here in the gallery, when they crawl to my feet and beseech me to take the reins of the bank again, the new bank they have started and can't carry on.
Here I shall stand and receive them. And it shall be known all far and wide, all over the land, what conditions John Gabriel Borkman imposes before he will... Perhaps you don't believe they will come.
Oh, heaven knows I do.
I firmly believe it. I'm immovably convinced. I know they will come. If I had not been certain of it, I would have put a bullet through my head long ago.
Oh, for God's sake, no.
But they will come. They will come. Sure enough, you shall see. I'm expecting them any day, any moment. As you see, I hold myself in readiness to receive them.
If only they would come quickly.
Yes. Time flies. The years slip away. Life.
I dare not think of it. Do you know what I sometimes feel like, Wilhelm?
What?
I feel like a Napoleon who has been maimed in his first battle.
I have that feeling too.
Yes, but yours is on a smaller scale, of course.
My little world of poetry is very precious to me, John Gabriel.
Yes, but think of me who could have controlled millions. All the mines, new veins, innumerable quarries, the waterfalls, the trade routes, all the great steamship lines all over the world. I would have organized it all, I alone.
Yes, I know. There was nothing you would have shrunk from, John Gabriel.
And now I have to sit here and watch as all the others pass me by in the race and take everything from me piece by piece.
That is my fate, too.
But to think of it, so near to the goal, if I had only had one more week, all the deposits would have been covered, all of the securities I had leverage so daringly would have been in place, not a soul would have lost a cent.
Yes, you were on the very verge of success.
And then treachery struck just at the critical moment. Do you know what I consider the most infamous crime a man can be guilty of?
No, tell me, John Gay.
It isn't robbery. It isn't perjury. It isn't murder. People do those for those they hate or who are indifferent to them and who don't matter. The most infamous of crimes is a friend's betrayal of his friend's confidence.
Yes.
The people who had their securities in the bank would have got them back every penny. No, I tell you, the most infamous of crimes is to take a friend's letters and to publish to all the world what has been confided to him in the strictest of secrecy, like a whisper in a dark, double-locked room. The man who can do such a thing is infected and poisoned in every fibre with models of the highest criminality.
Such a friend was mine, and it was he who crushed me.
I can guess whom you mean.
There wasn't a nook or cranny of my life that I hesitated to open to him, lay open to him. And then the moment came. He turned against me the weapon I myself had placed in his hands.
I just never understood why, mon Dieu, there were whispers at the time.
What whispers? Tell me. You see, I know nothing. I went straight into isolation. What did people whisper, Wilhelm?
That you were to have gone into the cabinet.
Was offered a portfolio, but I refused it.
Well, wasn't there that you stood in his way?
No, that wasn't the reason he betrayed me.
Then I really don't understand.
I suppose I'd better tell you, Wilhelm.
What?
You see, there was, in fact, there was a woman in the case.
A woman in the case? John! David.
Yes, yes, let us talk no more of these stupid old stories. After all, neither of us got into the cabinet, neither he nor I.
Yes, but he rose high in the world.
And I fell into the abyss.
Terrible tragedy.
Almost as terrible as yours.
Oh, at least as terrible.
But looked at from another point of view, it's really a sort of comedy as well.
A comedy?
Yes,
the story of your life?
Yes, it seems to be taking a turn in that direction. For let me tell you, you say you didn't see little Frieda as you came in.
No.
As we sit here, she is playing waltzes for the guests of the man that betrayed and ruined me.
I had no idea of
yes.
that.
She took her music and went straight for me to the great house.
Oh, but the poor
And
child.
Can you guess for whom she's playing among the rest?
No.
For my son.
What?
What do you think of that, Wilhelm? My son is down there in the whirl of the dance tonight. Am I not right in calling it a comedy? Oh,
but you can be sure he knows nothing about it.
He knows as sure as I'm sitting here.
Well, then how can he be a guest in that house?
He probably thinks Kinkalone, it is confounded duty when he went and betrayed me.
My dear friend, who could have gotten to see things in that light?
Who?
Do you forget who brought him up? First his aunt for the first 6 or 7 years of his life, and then his mother.
I am sure you're doing them an injustice.
I never do anyone an injustice. Both of them have poisoned his mind against me, I tell you.
Well, I suppose they have.
These women, they wreck and ruin life for us. They play the devil with our whole destiny, our triumphal progress.
Not all of them.
Indeed. Do you know a single one who is any good for anything?
No, that's the trouble. The few I do know are good for nothing. But it is a blessed, beneficial thought that
somewhere in the world, here or there, far away, the true woman really does exist.
Oh, do spare me that poetical nonsense.
Call my holiest faith poetical nonsense.
Yes, I do. That is what has always prevented you from getting on in the world. If you would get rid of all that from your... I'd still be able to help you on in life, help you rise.
You can't do that.
I can when I come into power again.
It won't be for many a day.
Perhaps you believe that day will never come. Answer me.
I don't know what to say.
And I no longer have any use for you.
No use?
Since you do not believe the tide will turn for me...
How can I believe in the teeth of all reason? You would have to be legally rehabilitated, and there's no precedent for that.
Exceptional men are above precedents.
The law knows no such distinction.
You are no poet, Wilhelm.
And you say that in sober earnest?
We're only wasting each other's time. You better not come here again.
You want me to leave you?
I no longer have any use for you.
No, I dare say so.
You've been lying to me all the time.
Never lying, John Gabriel.
Have you not sat here feeding me with faith, trust, and confidence? Was it all a lie?
It wasn't a lie. As long as you believed in me, I believed in you.
Then we've been deceiving each other, possibly deceiving ourselves, both of us.
But isn't that the essence of friendship, John Gabriel?
Yes, you're right. Friendship means deception.
I have no poetic vocation.
You know,
and you can say that. So,
you know, I don't pretend to know much about these matters.
Oh, you probably know more than you realize. For I have had my doubts. I have wasted my whole life on a deception.
If you have no faith in yourself, you're on the downward path indeed.
That was why I got so much comfort coming here, to lean on your belief in me. But now you are a stranger to me, John Gabriel.
And you to me.
Good night, John Gabriel.
Night, Wilhelm.
Who is it? Come in.
Who are you, and what do you want with me?
It is I, Borkman.
Is it Ella? Is it Ella Rentheim?
Yes, it's your Ella, as you used to call me in the olden days, long, long ago. Can you recognize me? There are no dark curls on my neck now. The ones you once loved to twist around your fingers.
I had no idea you were in this part of the country.
I have only just arrived.
But why have you come all this way in winter now to see me?
You, among others.
Won't you sit down?
Yes, I need rest. It seems an endless time since we two met, Borkman, face to face.
Long, long time. Terrible things have passed since then.
A whole lifetime has passed. A wasted lifetime.
Wasted?
Yes, I say wasted. for both of us.
I cannot regard my life as wasted yet.
What about mine?
Oh, you have only yourself to blame, Ella.
How dare you say that?
You could quite well have been happy without me.
Oh, I know well enough there was someone else ready to marry me.
Yet you refused him. You rejected him.
Yes, I did.
Time after time you rejected him, year after year.
Year after year I rejected happiness, I suppose you think.
You might perfectly well have been happy with him. Then I should have been saved.
You?
Yes, you would have saved me, Ella.
How do you mean?
He thought I was at the bottom of your obstinacy, of your perpetual refusals. And so he took his revenge. It was so easy for him. He had all my frank and confidential papers in his keeping. And when the time came, he made his own use of them. Then it was all over with me, for the time, that is to say, Ella. So, you see, it was all your doing, Ella.
So I owe you reparation, Borkman.
It depends how you look at it. I know quite well all you've done for us. I know all the sacrifices you've made for your sister and for me, but you were in a position to do so, and you must not forget it.
It was I who placed you in that position.
Oh, you're mistaken. It was the love of my inmost heart for Earhart and for you that made me do it.
Dear Ella, don't let's get sentimental. If you acted generously, it was I who placed you in a position to do so.
Do you place me in a position to do so?
Yes. On the eve of the great decisive battle, when I could afford to spare neither kith nor kin, when I did grasp at all of the millions in my care, then I spared all that was yours. Every cent, though I could have taken them and used them as I did of all the rest.
I have often wondered what your real reason was for sparing all my property.
Upon my soul, Ella, it's not easy to remember one's motives of 20 years ago. I only know that when I used to grapple silently and alone with all the great projects that I had in my mind, I had something of the feeling of a man starting out on a balloon voyage. All through my sleepless nights, I was inflating my giant balloon, preparing to soar away to perilous unknown regions.
And that was why I wouldn't take you and yours with me on the voyage.
What do you mean? Why? Tell me why.
One shrinks from risking what one holds dearest on such a voyage.
Oh, you had risked what was dearest to you on that voyage. Your whole future life.
Life was not always what one holds dearest.
Was that how you felt then? Was I then the dearest thing in your life?
I seem to remember something of the sort.
And yet years had passed since you had deserted me and married another.
Deserted?
Other motives, higher motives compelled me. Without his help, I could not have done anything.
So you deserted me from higher motives?
He made you the price of helping me. I had no choice. I had to conquer or fall.
Can what you tell me be true? Was I then the dearest thing in the world to you?
Both then and afterwards, long, long after.
But you bartered me away nonetheless. You drove a bargain with another man for your soul. You sold my soul for a directorship.
I was driven by inexorable necessity.
Criminal!
Oh, I've heard that word before.
Oh, don't imagine I'm thinking of anything you may have done against the law of the land. The use you made of those vouchers and securities or whatever you call them, do you think I care a straw about anything of that? If I could have been at your side when the crash came.
What then, Ella?
I would have borne it gladly along with you. The shame, the ruin, trust me, I would have borne it all. I would have helped you to bear it all. All.
But would you have had the will, the strength?
Both the will and the strength, for then I did not know of your terrible crime.
What crime? What are you speaking of?
I'm speaking of the crime for which there is no forgiveness.
You are out of your mind.
You are a murderer. You've committed the one mortal sin.
You are raving, Ella.
You have killed the love life in me. Do you understand what that means? The Bible speaks of a mysterious sin for which there is no forgiveness. I could never understand what it could be, but now I understand. The great, unpardonable sin is to murder the love life in a human soul. That you deserted me and turned to Gunhild instead, I put that down to mere common fickleness on your part and the result of heartless scheming on hers. I even think I despised you a little, in spite of all the rest. But now I see it. You deserted the woman you loved. Me. Me! Me!
How well
what I... you held dearest in the world, you were ready to barter away for gain. That is a double murder you have committed. The murder of your own soul and of mine.
How well I recognize your passionate, ungovernable spirit, Ella. But of course, you are a woman.
Only your heart exists for you.
It's true. It's all I care about.
But you must remember, I am a man. As a woman, you were the dearest thing in the world to me. But if the worst comes to the worst, one woman can always take the place of another.
Made Gunhild your wife?
No, but the great aims I had in life helped me to bear even that. I wanted to have under my command all of the sources of power in the land, all the wealth hidden in the soil, in the rocks, in the rivers, the sea. I wanted to bring it all into my hands, make myself master of it all, and so to promote the well-being of many, many thousands.
I know it. Think of all the evenings we spent talking over your projects.
Yes, I could talk to you, Ella.
I jested with you. I said to you, do you want to awaken all the sleeping spirits of the mine?
I remember that phrase, all the sleeping spirits of the mines.
But you didn't take it as a jest. You said, yes, Ella, yes, that is exactly what I want to do.
And so it was. If only I could get my foot in the stirrup. And that all depended on that one man.
He would and could help me to secure control of the bank. If I, on my side...
If you, on your side, would renounce the woman you loved, and who loved you beyond words in return. And so you struck the bargain.
I had to, and he helped me halfway up to the beckoning heights I was bent on reaching.
I mounted, year by year, I mounted.
And I had been wiped out of your life.
And after all, he held me into the abyss again.
On account of you, Ella.
Borkman, doesn't it seem to you as though there had been a sort of a curse on us?
A curse?
Yes, don't you think so?
Yes, I suppose so. But why is that? Can't decide who is right, you or I, Ella.
Oh, it is you who have sinned. You have done to death all the gladness of my life in me.
Oh, don't say that, Ella.
From the day your image began to dwindle in my mind, I have lived my life as though under an eclipse. During all these years, it has become harder and harder, until now utterly impossible for me to love any living creature, human being, animal, plant. I have shrunk from all but one.
What one?
Earhart, of course.
Has he really been so close to your heart?
Why else do you think I have took him and kept him as long as I could? Why?
Well, I thought it was out of pity, like all the rest you did.
Pity? I haven't known pity since you deserted me. You have created an empty, barren desert within me, and without me too. Except for Earhart. But I am hardened to every other living thing. You have cheated me of a mother's joy and happiness in life, and of a mother's tears and sadness too. And perhaps that is the heaviest loss of all. But at the time I could not face the loss. I could not resign myself to it. And that is why I took Earhart to me and kept him as long as I could. I won him entirely. His whole warm, trustful, childish heart. Until his mother in the flesh, I mean, took him away. I must have my boys on heart again, whole and undivided, now.
Their heart is in his mid-twenties. You could scarcely reckon on keeping his heart undivided very long.
I wouldn't need it for very long.
Indeed. I should have thought if you want something, you want it to the end of your days.
So I do, but that may not be for very long.
What do you mean by that?
You know, I have been ill for years.
Have you?
Hasn't Earhart told you?
A certain person below keeps him away, you understand.
Are you quite sure of that?
Yes, absolutely sure. So, you've been in bad health, Ella?
Yes, I have. And this autumn I grew so much worse, I had to come to town for the specialists.
Have you seen the doctors already?
Yes, this morning.
And what did they say to you?
They gave me full assurance of what I had long suspected.
Well?
My illness can never be cured, Borkman. The doctors can do nothing but let it take its course and allay the pain. At least that is something.
But what in all the world could have brought on this illness? You've always led a healthy and regular life. What can have brought it on?
The doctors thought that at some time in my life I must have suffered a tremendous emotional stress.
Ah, emotion. I understand. You mean it is my fault?
Oh, not at all. I myself would have stood and taken it proudly and gladly along with you.
Take him, Ella, if you can win him.
Do you give your consent? Can you?
Yes. But it's no great sacrifice either, for in any case he isn't mine.
Oh, thank you. Thank you all the same for the sacrifice. But there is one more thing I must beg of you.
Well, what
it's
is
a
it?
Very great thing for me. Oh, you will think it childish. You will not understand.
Go on, tell me what it is.
When I am gone, let Earhart bear my name.
I see. You want to spare my son, save my son from having to bear his father's name.
It's not that. I would have borne it myself. It's just that it means everything to me. It means more to me than you can think or imagine.
Well and good, Ella. I am man enough to bear my own name alone.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. You have made full settlement between us. Oh, yes, let it be so. Now there is full, you have made as full atonement as you are capable of making. For when I have left this world, I shall leave Earhart rent I'm behind me.
Never to his dying day shall Earhart be called by
I allow name. No one up into my room.
I do not ask your permission.
What do you want with me?
I will fight with all my might for you. I will protect you from the powers of evil.
Oh, the worst powers of evil are in yourself, Gunhild.
So be it. But this I tell you. He shall bear his father's name and bear it aloft in honour again. My son's heart shall be mine. Mine and no other's.
Earhart's life will be wrecked in the storm. Oh, Borkman, there must be an understanding between you and Gunhild. We must go down to her at once.
We?
Yes, both you and I.
She is hard, I tell you. As hard as the metal I once dreamed of hewing out of the rocks.
Then try it now.